My name is Wayne Kaito. I'm coordinator of Asian Studies Program and professor of history here at Bridgewater State University. I would like to welcome all of you today to come to this special lecture by the Consul General of Japan in Boston, Mr. Takeshi Hikihara. Back in December last year, we contacted the Consulate General of Japan in Boston, and requested the Consul General to speak with us as a part of our distinguished lecture series for ambassadors and dignitaries from different countries. And over the years, we have invited dignitaries coming from different countries, such as Canada, Vietnam, Bahrain, Israel, to name just a few. And each year, we wanted to invite some politicians to come to our country, to come to our campus to discuss issues of international concerns. And then in March, and as you all know, on March 11th, a 9.0 earthquake and tsunami hit Japan. And we have all seen the photographs and the coverage of the devastations that had hit Japan since for over a month now. So the visit of the Consul General was planned many months ago. And so we are really timely this year. This time to ask the Consul General to come to our campus to give this lecture. So it's really a special occasion. We wish that it would be under better circumstances, but it's also very important for him to talk about Japan in this difficult time and also give us some ideas about how Japan is going forward from now on. So without further ado, I would like to introduce our Vice President of External Affairs, Dr. Edward Minnock, who's actually who's mainly responsible for developing all the international relations on campus. Our Vice President Minnock has established over 23 formal exchange agreements with countries all over the world. And one of the most important relationships has always been Japan. And we have had Japanese students to come to our campus since 1993. Regularly since 1993. And we also had one of the earliest students who came here back in 1875, who was one of the leaders of modern Japanese education. So the relationship with Japan is very special here at Bridgewater State University. So I would like to introduce Dr. Edward Minnock to give some welcoming remarks and also introduce the Consul General of Japan, Mr. Hikihara. Please, Dr. Minnock.
Thank you, Winkai. Before I introduce the Consul General, I just wanted to make a comment. Dr. Winkai To is the director of our Asian Studies program and has been particularly instrumental in establishing a number of partnerships in countries throughout Asia. We currently have two formal partnerships in Japan, one in Wakayama and one at Kansai University. And later this year, the president and I are planning to go to Ina, which is in the southern part of Japan. Ina is the hometown of a graduate of Bridgewater. Goes way back, much older than anybody else here in the room. Back in the 1870s, Tsuji Isawa graduated from Bridgewater State University, at that time Bridgewater Normal School, and then returned to Japan, where he became the founding father for the normal school movement, and is recognized there. I was talking with the Consul General this morning, and he immediately recognized the name and said that he's also very well known in the country of Japan for his music education. So Professor To has been extremely instrumental in helping us develop those. We're going to be hearing a little bit about the earthquake in a few minutes. And when the earthquake hit, we had one of our students in Tokyo at the time. And just by coincidence, I happened to meet with her stepfather earlier last week, and then Marissa contacted me. She's on her way back to Tokyo now. She was in a program with Temple University, a partnership there, and they first sent her back to the United States, and she was going to take her courses online, but as things have changed a little bit now, she's returning, so we now have a student back in Japan. So we're moving on that. as an aside, totally in a separate area, but while I'm thinking about it with Wing Kai, and sort of as a promotional piece. Sitting behind Wing Kai is Lisa Donegan McAdam, and she's the director of our study abroad program. We have a faculty member currently in Hong Kong, and he just emailed myself and Wing Kai this morning and said that the Hong Kong Institute of Education is particularly interested in seeing more of our students go over there, and their president will be here this fall. And so any of the students that are here that have an interest in going to Japan or Hong Kong or even China, I recommend that you talk with Lisa and start that conversation now so we can move forward. All right, enough of the promotional stuff. Let me talk for a minute about our guests here. In addition to the Consul General, we also have the Vice Consul. Mika Iga is with him today, so I'd like to first of all introduce her and say thank you for coming. And then Consul General Hikihara is here. The Consul General just arrived in Massachusetts at the beginning of the year, in January. And typically, the Consul General's terms are 2 to 3 years in a country. So we're hoping to see him here for the next couple of years and be actively involved in some of the work that the university is doing with Japan. The Consul General has also served. He's been in the diplomatic service for over 30 years and was also stationed at one time in Senegal, in France, and in Russia. So he comes to us with a wealth of experience. And fortunately for us, he's here, but unfortunately, when we invited him, we were inviting him to talk about the relationship between Japan and the university. And in the last few weeks, as everyone knows, the devastation that's hit Japan has caused all of our attention to be focused there in a different way. And so today the Consul General is going to talk a little bit about the impact that that's having on the country, and then talk a little bit about what we might be able to do in terms of helping with that. So at this time I'd like to invite the Consul General to come to the podium and give him a Bridgewater round of applause.
Thank you, Dr. Minnock, for the very kind introduction. Thank you for giving me occasion to come here and speak before you. I feel particularly honored to come to this university, as Dr. Minnock mentioned. This is university where the founding father of modern Japanese education and the founding father of Japanese musical education, Dr. Shujizawa, studied 130 years ago. So I really feel particularly honored. And at the same time, I would like to thank you for the all the efforts that you are deploying here after the earthquake. I have been told that you are organizing such a great events in art and music concert and charity events, money collecting, etc., for the sake of the victims back in Japan. So I really would like to thank you. Having said so, I would like to get into my subjects there. I'm going to talk mainly about two things. One is, of course, about earthquake and the what we are trying to do after the earthquake, with, of course, the help of the international community, including the United States. And the second subject, if I have time, I would like to touch upon the Japan-US relation as it stands now. So first, the Japan after the earthquake. I marked here after the earthquake, but we are still in the process of struggling because this earthquake is not just a one-time devastation, but an ongoing challenge. So we are really in the midst of multifaceted challenges. But let me first explain very quickly what really happened on March 11th. The earthquake, the which hit Japan just a month ago, was of a really unprecedented size and power. The magnitude 9.0 is the biggest earthquake that we have experienced in our history, at least our recorded history, and fifth biggest in from 1900 worldwide. And it was not just a one-time big shock, but we have got so many aftershocks, as you will see here. We have got a magnitude 7, a magnitude 6 level aftershocks already more than 70 times. So it is very severe situation. This is a geological explanation of the earthquake. We have got four. Japan is on the four plates, the continental or oceanic plates, and they see the. This is the Pacific plate, which always is pushing the North American plate, and there is of course tension mounting, and the release of that tension this time caused the big earthquake. The damage given to the by this earthquake was really terrific. We have got a tsunami wave higher than 45 feet, and the Dow claims the lives of more than 1,300 people. 13,000 people, and still we have got a missing people of 15,000, and almost 140,000 people are still evacuated. And on top of that, of course, we have got this serious problem, nuclear problem of Fukushima Daiichi Station that I'm going to touch up a bit later. And first, for the all this devastation by earthquake and tsunami, we are as government of Japan and the local authorities concerned, really deploying all out efforts for the search and rescue operation and to the supply of emergency need. More than 100,000 staff of our self defense forces, which are more than half of our military staff, are being deployed for that objective, on top of more than 20,000 police officers, 27,000 firefighters and coastal guards, doctors, and, health workers, etc. And for the nuclear problem, this is a really serious problem. We have got in total 14 nuclear units in the area affected by this earthquake, and all of them are now closed down. Most of them are closed down normally. They've got an automatic shutdown with cooling system in operation. But we have got Fukushima Daiichi Station, which are the nearest to the epicenter, has got a serious problem. I'm going to explain. So this is the situation of before and after the earthquake of the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power station. You see the we have got four reactors, six reactors, six units here, and this is after. You see these are the units 1, 2, 3, 4. So you see that for unit 1, 3, and 4. They have almost lost the building covering the container vessel. What really happened is that for the earthquake, it was more or less okay. Even if the strength of the earthquake was so huge, they stood well against the earthquake. But we lost the offsite power because of the shock of the earthquake. That was the first problem. And the second problem is the tsunami. These plants are on the coast of the Pacific Ocean. And of course, there is a preparation against the tsunami. We've got a big barrage here. and the building itself is on elevation about 10 meters over sea level. We thought that they were well prepared for a biggest tsunami possible, but the one that came this time was simply beyond our imagination, was estimated 40 meters. So they broke through the barrage and going over this elevation and gave a serious damage to diesel generators, which should replace the offsite power in case of trouble. So the offsite power was lost and the diesel generator became inoperable. And we've got a serious problem, especially a serious problem of cooling the system. So after this accident, the key challenge is multifaceted. First, we have to cool down the reactors. And of course, we have to contain the spread of radioactive substances. And monitoring, rigorous monitoring is indispensable. And we have to secure the safety of food and drinking water. And of course, those who are struggling on site. One of the most basic things that we really have to do is monitoring the radioactivity around the area. And we are doing really our utmost effort to for that purpose. The monitoring the radioactivity every 10 minutes, and we release the results immediately. So literally, minute by minute, we can follow the situation in that area. And this is the result up to the beginning of April. You see that there's a big release, a rise in radioactive level in mid-March. But then we have got a steady decline in the releases, and the situation are more or less stabilized so far. And these are the radioactivity level in the cities surrounding the Fukushima Daiichi plant. These cities are in the distance of 40 or 60, 90 kilometers. And as you see, all these results, the radioactive level are in steady decline. And the major cities in Japan, about Tokyo or Osaka. Tokyo is about 230 kilometers from this Fukushima Daiichi plant. And the radioactive level of Tokyo is within the normality, as the normal level of radioactivity in Tokyo is 0.035 microsievert. And now we are less than 0.1 microsievert, so we are getting back to quite near to the normal situation. And one more effort, a very important effort, is to secure the safety of food. We are inspecting the radiation dosages every day, inspecting 70 vegetable items, 40 seafood foods, and more than 10 meat and eggs, so we are trying to monitor the and catch try to catch the every possible risk. For the vegetables, toward the end of March, early April, we have detected a certain accumulation of radioactivity in vegetables, 10 or 12 vegetables. So we have introduced a restriction of circulation for these vegetables and milk also. But after the continuing monitoring on 8th and 10th of April, we have removed some restriction of some items as the situation are being improved. And for seafood also, we try to monitor the situation as closely as possible. But in fact, In near the devastated area, there is no fishing activity. In around these areas, all the fishing ports were devastated, so in no use, so there is no activity. And these areas, there is a voluntary restraint by the fishery cooperative associations. So all these areas,
there is practically no fishing activity. So there is no possibility that any fish product with radioactivity will go in circulation. And for the safety of drinking water, tap water, once we have observed a certain rise in the radioactivity in tap waters in Tohoku area and even in Tokyo, so we have introduced a restriction of intake of tap water for adults and for babies, but the radioactivity level came back to normal level very quickly, so we have already removed all the restriction but only in one village near the power plant. The situation of tap water in Tokyo, as you see in this
schema, is coming back to normal level
toward the end of last month. Through all this monitoring and restriction, the most important thing is the accuracy of information, because on one hand, of course, we have to secure the safety of consumers, but at the same time, we have to prevent unjustifiable importation regulations, unjustifiable harm to all these producers, or agricultural producers, or the fishermen, and all these people related to these activities, because these activities, agriculture, fishing, are very important for the restoration of the devastated areas. So of course we have to be very careful about the safety of consumers. We have to unnecessary manner. We have to avoid to hamper the economic activities, revival of economic activities in these areas. And in this context, I would like to mention that, as I told you, there would be no risk that contaminated food or milk or whatever would go into distribution system in Japan. And also, there would be no restriction on travel to Japan, no any international organizations like IMO, ICAO, or IATA, no international organizations issued any restriction on travel to Japan. We try for the sake of the transparency and accuracy of information, we try to secure the speedy dissemination of information related. So all these sites are all in English. You can consult any time for any kind of information if you need. And while we are really trying to struggle through all these challenges, we have been getting so many assistance from the world, and we really thankful. We feel really thankful on this help. We have got 24 search and rescue teams from around the world, including, of course, the United States, and more than 40 countries have sent us relief goods, emergency to fulfill the emergency needs in the devastated area, and there are more on the way. From the United States, we have got two rescue teams from USAID, specialists from Nuclear Regulatory Commissions and Department of Energy. and a big operation by the U.S. forces stationed in Japan, the operation Tomodachi. Tomodachi is a Japanese word for friendship. They have deployed the Ronald Reagan aircraft carrier and other vessels, a lot of aircraft, mainly helicopters, and more than 20,000 military personnel. It's a big operation jointly conducted with our self-defense forces. And not only the government, the effort on the government level, we have got so many assistance, especially when as far as we are concerned at the Consulate General in Boston, we have got a lot of assistance from New England, from your university, and from the students, music students in Berkeley, American, Japanese American, and other nationalities. They are giving charity concerts. And this is also a charity concert given in the Boston Higashi School. This is a special school for the students who are suffering autism. So they are disabled students, I should say, but was really did a good job, a very moving concert. And this is a photo of devastated area in Fukushima. This gentleman with red jacket is a JET OB, the Japanese exchange program. He was once worked. He once worked as an English teacher in the region, and then after the earthquake, he came back to that area as a volunteer, and he met with his one of his students. So, still there are some photos of all these charity events, prayers and vigils. These are photos of the vigil organized in Old South Church in Boston. These are students from Harvard coming to my office. And effort on the part of Red Sox. These are four Japanese players collecting money, collecting money campaign. And Jason Bytek, the team captain, also joined their effort. With all this support from the international community, we are now getting slowly into the reconstruction period. Of course, the most seriously devastated areas, we have to still going. We are still conducting the search and rescue operation, but in parallel, we have to. We started to think about how to restore and reconstruct the area. For the infrastructure, things are now getting back to the normal, more or less normal situation. Roads and railways and airports. The Sendai Airport, which were seriously devastated by the earthquake, became operational 2 days ago. So we have got a full. Air liaison. Still, the ports are still in a very severe situation. How to evaluate, in economic terms, all this damage given by the earthquake and the tsunami? It is said a very early estimate by the by our government is something between $200 or $300 billion dollars. Which is a huge amount of money. But we have got precedents in handling this serious damage stock problem. We have got a big earthquake 15 years ago in Hanshin, Osaka and Kobe area. The damage given at that time to the area was in the order of $120 billion, so more or less half of the damage given this time. But for this earthquake 15 years ago, the recovery was done. in principle, in 3 years, the government spent more than $40 billion in 3 years, and the private investment of, in the order of $70 or $80 billion came in 3 years, and the region have become fully recovered in 3 years. The macroeconomic impact of this earthquake on Japanese economy, the first the direct damage, which is because of the loss of stock, the loss of investment stock, which was, as I told you, something between $200 to $300 million, that will result in the decrease of something like 0.5 or 1.25% of GDP. Also, we have got indirect damages. One of these indirect damages is a supply chain problem, because there are in this devastated area of Tohoku, we have got many factories of, for instance, semiconductors, which provide very precious and indispensable parts to, for instance, car industry or electric appliance industries. So there, and all these factories are in trouble now. And also we have got, of course, consumer psychology problem, because people feel unsecured and try to spend less money for the future, etc. So these indirect damage, it can be in the order of 0.25% of GDP. But all these reconstruction efforts that we are going to deploy in coming years, in 3, 4, 5 years, will be a positive side of positive, we should have a positive effect on Japanese macroeconomy in the order of 2 or 3 or even 5% of GDP. So in total, theoretically, from the later half of this year, the impact on the Japanese GDP should be positive. But there is one more element that we really can't measure. It's difficult to foresee is the problem of electric supply, because we have, as I told you, we have lost the supply, electric supply from all nuclear plants in that region, which amounts to something like 16 or 70% of the supply of electricity in Tohoku and Kanto area, including Tokyo. That we pose a serious problem. We try to fix this problem by urgently increasing the generation capacity by other means. It's a race against time. So in our reconstruction effort, of course, short-term efforts are being done for rehabilitation of housing or industrial facilities. But for mid and longer term, we would like to do something of something of added value. For longer term, we would like to make a steep planning a city for disaster resilient, economic friendly, and welfare oriented planning are on the agenda. We have already set up a reconstruction planning council, a body of private persons who is going to give the advice to our prime minister. And all these economic situation, how the Japanese economy will recover, would have a serious impact on the world economy, and including the United States, American economy. The one channel of this influence is, of course, supply chain. As I told you, the semiconductors, or the automobile parts, or electronics, or electronic parts, or even chemicals like paint are sometimes indispensable part of production abroad in the United States or in Asia, in other parts of Asia. You may have heard that the older Toyota factories or Nissan factories in the United States are at least momentarily stopped operation. But it is not the Japanese companies, but also Ford, GM are in trouble, and some of them, their factories are now stopped operation because of lack of supply of parts from Japan. Well, this is a rather important problem. There are other channels of influence decreasing demand in Japan, if it is the case, tourism and energy policy. When it comes to the energy policy, let me add that the nuclear energy will remain indispensable part of our energy mix, because we have got more than 30% of our generation, electric generation, from the nuclear power, and more than 10% in our primary energy mix. So of course we are going to strengthen the supply from other sources, including new energy or bio or clean energy or hydro energy, etc. Still, we have to rely on the nuclear power. So what we have to do is to take good lessons from this tragedy and try to make ourselves more or better prepared for the future incidents.